أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وعلى آله وصحبه ومن والاه وبعد. Today, inshallah, we are going to be talking about Surah Al-Hujurat. Al-Hujurat is the plural of the word Hujra. Kamra? Kamra in Urdu? Kamra? Hujra? Room? Hujra? Hujurat. Hujurat. Surah Madaniya. Madani. As you see, it is about lots of akhlaq. Actually, it is called Surah Al-Akhlaq. The Surah of Akhlaq. Surah of morals, of manners. Yes, it is to build the Muslim character and behavior on, as an individual with the leader and as a jama'ah. And it has also conflict resolution, as we'll see in a minute. So this surah is 18 ayahs, 18 ayahs. And it is a Madani surah. And it is called Al-Hujurat because it is referring to the Hujurat of Rasulullah, Al-Habib sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has a hujra for each of his wives. Not a house, not a palace, not a castle for each one. As happened after the khilafah. Then any emir had the palace for the hukum, a palace for his own enjoyment, palace for his child, this, child, that, palaces. But Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, very, very humble from beginning to end. Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. From beginning to end. If you see the model of his house that he was raised in, his house, the house of his father and mother, or the house that he married with Khadija radiallahu anha, or the houses that he lived with, very similar. Very similar. Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam never slept in a bed. Never slept in a bed. He sallallahu alayhi wa sallam put his comforter under him, which was stuffed with the leaves of the date palm tree. You know, this part on the top, very soft, you know, fibers. The fibers on the top, leaf, hashwuha min leaf. That is his pillow, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and the mattress. Not mattress, folded comforter. One time they folded his comforter, an extra one, for him to be comfortable. He did not wake up in the same time for tahajjud. He said, don't do this again. Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Al-Hasan al-Basri, one of the tabi'een, he went to Umm Salama. Umm Salama radiallahu anha, the wife of Rasulullah, she is the one who raised him. The great scholar, Hasan al-Basri. He said that if you stand, when he was a teenager, when he stand in the house of Umm Salama, the room يعني, of Umm Salama, if he put his hand, he touches the ceiling. If he put the hand, he touches the ceiling. And if you are standing, you lean to the right, you touch this wall, you lean to the left, you touch the other wall. That is the room of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and all the hujurat was the same. And you can even relate to this. How many of us went to Umrah or Hajj here? Umrah or Hajj. You know the hujra where Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is buried? And Sayyidina Abu Bakr and Sayyidina Umar. You know this hujra, you can see the rawda, the width of the rawda. This is the hujurat, right? And then from this side, you know the beginning and the end of the door. You can visualize, right? Basically, it is a room the size of this. Of this room we are sitting in now. A little bit bigger. You know what is this exactly? This is the hujurat of Rasulullah, all of them, with the hujra of Fatima and Ali. Radiallahu anhu, also included. And at the time of Sayyidina Uthman, he added also a couple of feet to it. So what you see now is all of this. People were living in that area like this. So you can imagine the life of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. It's like that. It's like a walk-in closet of someone now. Like that. So this is the hujra of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. This whole Masjid Nabawi, current Masjid Nabawi, is Medina and its suburbs at the time of Rasulullah. Anyone goes, yeah, outside of that, Baqi' was like kind of like out, far from Medina, yani Baqi', the Baqi', you know, the, you know, you see Baqi', Jannat al-Baqi', they say, you come out from the houses. So I'm just giving you the visual of at the time. If you go to Medina, and don't forget to go to the museum in the in front of Haram, Medina, Madani, and the one also in Masjid Quba. In front of Masjid Quba, there is two museums there. They will show you the whole Medina, and they will show you the Masjid of Rasulullah, they will show you the history, they will show it in a movie in different languages and everything. So this is a very interesting one. And you can go on YouTube and find it as well. If you go to YouTube, you'll find it as well. In Urdu, in English, in Arabic, you will find exactly the history. It's very important to reflect. Yani when you say Hujurat, the word itself is humble. Did not say Buyut. Right? Did not say Buyut. The word Buyut mentioned later in Surah Al-Ahzab, right? لا تدخلوا بيوت النبي, right? بيوت النبي is the place where he مبيت, make a bait. But here it's called حجرات to show us humble. يعني this is a general one. So حجرات is the plural of the word حجرة, and it is referring, and there were nine حجرة. There were nine rooms. And the group came from Banu Tamim. They came to ask about Islam and all that. But Al-Arab, at that time, they had a habit. Whenever somebody new, or somebody coming up, or a new name comes, or a tribe achieves something else, all the other tribe challenges them. And challenges them with poetry, with speech, literature, يعني. Like someone now said, you know, you do business, I do business. They both go on the golf court, and each one, you know, display something. So they, every culture, they agree on something, becomes the competition, yeah. To prove yourself. Every culture is like that. They have a competition. So the Arab culture was about who is your speaker and who is your poet. So now they heard what? Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam gets the Quran. Huh? And he has Sahaba around him. But they forget that they are not from one tribe. يعني. They are from different tribes. But still they have this jahiliyyah. So they come and they come to them in the masjid. Behind the rooms of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, said, Ya Muhammad, come out. Not Ya Rasulullah or anything like that. They said, Ya Muhammad. No even respect to tell him, Ya Abu al-Qasim. You know, Abu such and such is a respect to Kunya, nickname in Arabic. Right? If you don't know anybody, you tell him, Ya Abu Abdullah, Ya Abu Muhammad. Yani if you don't know their Kunya, you call them with a, or you tell them, Ya Abdullah. See, you have to give some name respect. Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is older, he's a prophet, he's a messenger, he's a leader, he's from the middle of Quraysh, he's all of that. Yet they come with these manners. Right? And they say, Ya Muhammad, that's number one. Number two, they call him in a time that he was resting. Okay? Number three, they did not ask permission. This is his city, this is his Medina. And then they said, Ya Muhammad, come out. Listen to what we have to say. Anybody we praise, he becomes the respected one. And anybody we humiliate, he becomes the humiliated one. He said, this is the characteristic of Allah. And Rasul Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam got disturbed when they said that. Ya Muhammad, ukhruj, nufakhirka, fa inna madhana zain, wa inna hajwana, aw wa inna ya'ni dhammana shayn. Ya'ni anybody we praise, he becomes dignified. And anybody we do not praise, he becomes humiliated. He said, Hada Allah. The one who does this is Allah. يعني whomever Allah honor is the honored one. Whomever Allah humiliated is the humiliated one, not you. Rasulullah was disturbed because of this. Also, this surah is called Surah Al-Akhlaq, Surah Al-Adab, Adab etiquettes, wa akhlaq morals and manners. Because it tells us how to arrange our society. And this surah, subhanallah, is studied by many scholars. I think there is a book by Bilal Phillips to read, you know, if you want to read about that surah. But it is very concise compared to what is in the surah. And if you read the book of Bilal Phillips, you think that he did a lot. يعني. But he didn't actually. He just scratched the surface. Right? So the tafsir of this surah and the lessons came out from this surah. Yani there are many theses, masters and PhD about one aspect only of the surah. The adab with Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, 700-800 pages. The problem resolution, you know, dispute or conflict resolution, 700-800 pages. And this is repeats many times, right? The equality among the people, and all of us are equal. جعلناكم شعوبا وقبائل لتعارفوا, right? The etiquettes of Iman and Islam. From beginning to the end, this is one of a kind surah, يعني. One of a kind system, I'm sorry. All the surahs of Quran are the same, but one of a kind system mentioned in a surah that no human being can put this together like this. Miracle from Allah Azza wa Jal. Also, Allah called the believers 5 times in it. Ya ayyuha alladhina amanu, ya ayyuha alladhina amanu, ya alladhina amanu, ya alladhina amanu, ya alladhina amanu. And each one of them gives 5 orders. Obedience of Allah and His Rasul, 1. Dignifying and respecting Rasulullah, 2. Making sure of the news before you believe in it or you act upon it, 3. Do not, and the prohibition of mocking or looking down upon each other, 4. And the prohibition of backbiting and spying and all those things. So, you know, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا لَا يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا لَا يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا لَا You see? See the word لَا? Never happened in any surah like this, consecutive like this. Don't. All right? And if this happens, don't. You have to do such and such and such and such. So don't do this, don't do this, don't do this, don't do this. So that shows you also that Allah gives us orders not only by do, but also by don't. All right? So that's a surah that this also something is distinguishing about it. This surah relates to Surah Al-Fath. We studied Surah Al-Fath before. As I do every time, you know, when you start a surah, I tell you how it is related to the surah before, right? It showed us how the Muslims do in conflict at the time of war between them and the non-believers. And here it shows, يعني from out of state, out of the state of Islam, you are fighting with someone who's your enemy. Now, this surah is talking to us about those who have problems within the Muslim ummah. When somebody transgresses from within. Surah Al-Fath is telling us about somebody transgresses from out. This one here is saying, وَإِنْ طَائِفَتَانِ مِنَ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ اقْتَتَلُوا فَأَصْلِحُوا فَإِنْ بَغَتْ بَغِي يعني from within, from inside. Also, the previous surah, Surah Al-Fath, finishes by the promise of Allah to the believers that they will maghfiratan wa ajran azima. And here Allah told them to maintain this maghfiratan wa ajran azim, do not precede Rasulullah by, you know, this song. So it's a continuation by the believer character. How Allah tell the believer character to maintain that. You want maghfiratan wa ajran azim? Yes or no? Say, yes, so this is what you need to do and this is what you need to avoid. So don't say, oh Allah, وعد الله الذين آمنوا مغفرة وأجرا عظيما. Okay, خلاص, we are مغفرة وأجرا عظيما. لا تقدموا, لا ترفعوا, لا, you know, this to maintain that status for you. We're not the Sahaba. Sahaba, رضي الله عنهم ورضوا عنه, خلاص, finish this one. But anybody after that, be careful, you know. You have to finish on a good note. As I always say, you don't finish on a good note, no, finish on a high note. You know high note, right? This is a musical term, but we use it in a good way. Yeah, high note, يعني you finish high. The shuyukh in recitation of Quran, this is يعني beside the point, always they start slow and they finish what? Slow. No, they finish slow. أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. Like this. And when they finish it, صدق الله العظيم. They go down, right? That's the tradition. But there are certain sheikhs, they will finish on a high note. And they will make everybody like, why you finish? Continue. All right? So that's why we say you finish on a high note. Finish on a high note, not anybody can do. Because finishing on a high note is not a good thing for the ear. But somebody finish on a high note, song, finish a song on a high note, or recitation on a high note, means they are very confident. They are very sweet. They are very good. People want them to continue. That's what a believer is. All right? So when you want to finish your life, you want to finish it where? I know, inshallah. Okay. Also in both surahs, Allah Azza wa Jal honored Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He honored him, إِنَّ أَرْسَلْنَاكَ شَاهِدًا وَمُبَشِّرًا, right? وَنَذِيرًا. And this surah told us the honor of Rasulullah, how you deal with him. Through how we deal with him. Before, the status Allah give him. Now, the status that Allah give him, how we act according to it, both is to honor Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. This surah has lots of ahkam shar'iyya, have lots of shar'i ahkam, يعني, not about the day of judgment only, but about more of the rules in this dunya. يعني سور مكية, you find always آخرة, يوم القيامة, good people, bad people, the book with right hand, the book with left hand, you know, right? All of that. But in this surah, ahkam, rules, how you live your life. طبعا, of course, this is general etiquette. Also, it has specific etiquette with Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sahbihi wa sallam. يعني the unconditional obedience to Rasulullah is not like anybody else. Right? Sayyidina Abu Bakr, when he became Khalifa, he said, you obey me as I obey Allah and his Rasul. Very simple, right? But your obedience of Rasulullah is like the obedience of Allah, because he is sent by Allah. Allah said in the Quran, مَنْ يُطِعِ الرَّسُولَ فَقَدْ أَطَاعَ اللَّهِ. Clear, right? Whoever, anyone else? No. مَنْ يُطِعِ الرَّسُولَ فَقَدْ أَطَاعَ اللَّهِ. مَنْ يُطِعِ الْخَلِيفَةَ فَقَدْ أَطَاعَ اللَّهِ. Nope. مَنْ يُطِعِ الْأَمِيرَ فَقَدْ أَطَاعَ اللَّهِ. Nope. أَطِيعُ اللَّهَ وَأَطِيعُ الرَّسُولَ وَأُولِي الْأَمْرِ مِنْكُمْ, if they follow Allah and His Rasul. It's very clear, very clear. Sayyidina Imam Malik, he said, everybody, you accept from what they say, you reject from what they say, except Rasulullah. Imam Malik said that. You know, when somebody disagreed, he said, that's all right. You can disagree with me, you can disagree with anybody, as long as it is not Rasulullah. If you know that Rasulullah said this hukum, for sure, خلاص, that's it. You don't have a choice. Do you have a choice? وَمَا كَانَ لِمُؤْمِنٍ وَلَا مُؤْمِنَةٍ إِذَا قَضَى اللَّهُ وَرَسُولُهُ أَمْرًا أَنْ يَكُونَ لَهُ الْخِيَرَةُ مِنْ أَمْرِهِمْ إِنَّمَا كَانَ قَوْلَ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ إِذَا دُعُوا إِلَى اللَّهِ وَرَسُولِهِ لِيَحْكُمَ بَيْنَهُمْ أَنْ يَقُولُوا سَمِعْنَا وَأَطَعْنَا إِلَى اللَّهِ وَرَسُولِهِ, right? Whatever you do. So, only one, as a human being, for us, the only human being that you have to accept what he says without the condition is one person. هذا is Rasulullah Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Anybody after that, yes, we can take and with adab, of course, with etiquette. I'm not saying we're equal with Sayyidina Umar or Sayyidina Abu Bakr. I'm not saying that. Because some people misunderstand, you know. Sayyidina Rasulullah, Abu Bakr, me like him, the same. La, not the same. You're not the same. Okay? We're not the same. We're not the same level. But I'm just saying that who is the one infallible, ma'soom, is Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So this surah also is telling us that. Now, let's... I don't want to keep summarizing the surah, but the tafsir will show us, inshallah. So the first ayah, Ya ayyuha alladhina amanu, and Abdullah ibn Mas'ud, my brothers and sisters, said, whenever you hear Ya ayyuha alladhina amanu, listen attentively. Ida sami'ta Ya ayyuha alladhina amanu, fa'ar'iha sam'ak. It is something Allah Azza wa Jalla wants to tell you to do, or something Allah Azza wa Jalla is telling you to avoid. So that means when Allah said, Ya ayyuha alladhina amanu, everybody should pay attention. Everybody should pay attention. يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا لَا تُقَدِّمُوا بَيْنَ يَدَيِ اللَّهِ وَرَسُولِهِ. قَدَّمَ means preceding. That's why the مُقَدِّمَ is the introduction, is the preface. You know preface for a book? The preface? Like they write in the beginning, preface? Or مُقَدِّمَ introduction to anybody? Somebody is going to be the MC of a gathering. What they do? مُقَدِّمَ. مقدمة means the introduction to what is the program. هذا قدم. قدم يعني he started before anyone else. Is that clear? Allah said, يا أيها الذين آمنوا لا تقدموا بين يدي الله ورسوله. يد is this one here, hands. بين يدي يعني in front of. Allegorically, figuratively speaking, يعني before. Alright? So my father is sitting. Out of respect, I'm not supposed to start before him. My father is leaving, I'm not supposed to go before him. You know, like you find the children, they go, you know, the car, they open the door and enter the car. you entering the place, you hold the door for your father. You hold the door for your teacher. But you let them in. The only time the etiquette allows you to walk in front of someone higher than you is to protect them or to make way for them. That's it. That's why Sayyidina Abu Bakr used to walk in front of Rasulullah, behind Rasulullah. Why? Because he's afraid, protecting him. So that's the only time. But to walk out of preference, no. Imagine if it is Rasulullah. لا تقدموا بين يدي رسول الله. They say the reason of the ayah. طبعا, we agreed that reason of the ayah is one thing and the meaning of the ayah is another thing. يعني if the ayah is revealed for a specific reason, it does not mean it only applies to that reason. It applies general. طيب, what is the reason? They said الرسول صلى الله عليه وسلم, before he answers some question, somebody answers. That's not etiquette. In the Eid, one day, a person, he slaughters before Salah. طبعا صلاة العيد الأضحى, you have to slaughter when? After Salah. So someone slaughtered before Salah. Rasul صلى الله عليه وسلم said, don't slaughter before me. And one time in the Hadi, before Rasulullah slaughtered, somebody did. And those are some reasons, right? They say there are some reasons for the revelation of the surah. يعني. Also, some people, they start before Rasulullah fast in Ramadan, they start 2-3 days before him. Excited, huh? They are excited, you know, like, let's go, we'll do this thing, so you find them before you. يعني مثلا, if the Shaykh says, يا إخواني, let's meet to go visit someone, so you find some people over there before. It's not out of disrespect, but they are excited. But Allah is telling the Sahaba, even if you are excited, don't do before Rasulullah. Because you're setting examples. Sometimes your niyyah is good, but whoever looking at you does not understand. So that's why sometimes we have to be very careful when we're teaching our children and all of that, what you do. Because they don't understand how we deal with each other. So we have to deal with etiquette, certain etiquette agreed upon. So all of these are some of the reasons might come, but the general idea is do not precede Rasulullah, do not precede the hukm of Allah and say, my opinion is such and such. Yaqi, listen, what if I bring you an ayah says the difference? Then you become, you look bad now. So, you know, this is, I think this ayah means such and such. Don't think, just hold on. See, how did the people 1400 years before said about it? Then let's see, your thinking is right or wrong. I told you before, I asked one of my sheikhs, I told him, ya sheikh, sometimes when I'm reciting the Quran, after all my studies and everything, I told him, sometimes I read the Quran and an idea comes in my head about the verse. Thought, يعني, خاطرة. And I want to share it. He said, don't do that. He said, don't share it. Because I know that the idea is not anything I read. It's something new, originally. Right? So he told me, don't. I told him, what I should do? He said, whenever this happens to you, wait and go search and read. One of few things will happen. One, you find somebody already said it before you. So alhamdulillah, you are not the first one. Huh? So this is, you are following someone good. That means you are a good man. So you should feel good about yourself. That some of the Sahaba said it, some of the Tabi'een said it. You will become happy. That, you know, mashallah, I got the same idea these great people got, means I am a good also. So that's one. Or you find that they said opposite. Then you have to hold now and say why. Analyze why it is opposite. Why? What is wrong with mine? Then you will correct yourself. Or you find someone said part of it. So you say, alhamdulillah, I'm completing things. But do not rush and act upon it. He said the result of this, my son, my sheikh said, the result of this, after years and years of experience, you will find that your thoughts are not wild anymore. You see the philosophy here? He said, your thoughts will be well trained. يعني, any thought that comes to you, it comes within a certain track. And this is the ni'mah of Allah of knowledge. You see how people think? So what I'm saying, sometimes you get excited, and we act, and then later on, 10 years later, you know that you were wrong. He said, Subhanallah, I've been saying this 10 years. I've been understanding this ayah wrong 10 years. It becomes very hard on you, right? So calm down and don't rush before Allah and His Rasul in the tafsir and in the hadith and all of that. Are we clear on this one?
Mm.
So be very, very, very careful when it comes to this is what Allah means or that's what Rasulullah means. Be very careful with that. It's better to listen and try to analyze and think than to rush and say then you regret later on. Rasulullah said, whoever say something I did not say, let him go find his place in hellfire. If anybody say something I did not say. How about those who say about Allah? Allah said, وَنْ أَظْلَمُ مِمَّنْ افْتَرَى عَلَى اللَّهِ الْكَذِبِ. Yani the one who say that Allah said something and Allah did not say. So be very, very careful, يا أخواني. لَا تُقَدِّمُوا بَيْنَ يَدَيِ اللَّهِ وَرَسُولِهِ وَاتَّقُوا اللَّهَ إِنَّ اللَّهَ يا أيها الذين آمنوا لا تقدموا بين يدي الله ورسوله اتقوا الله إن الله سميع عليم. Allah is hearing what you do and Allah is knowing what is in your intention. Every time you see سميع عليم means what? Something you said and there is an intention. Allah سميع بصير, something you said and something you showed. You know what I mean? So whenever you see سميع and بصير means he hears and he sees. That means you said something and you did something. So Allah sees. But Sami'un Alim, you said something, but you had an intention behind it. So you have to understand that the ending of the ayah comes also in sync with the meaning. لا تقدموا بين يدي الله ورسوله. Allah knows what is your intention. Allah hear you. متقوا الله إن الله سميع عليم. Then comes a very strong ayah. ثابت ابن قيس ابن شماس. ثابت ابن قيس ابن شماس is a صحابي of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He had some kind of deafness in his ear. You know, some people, their hearing is not strong. Alright? So what is the result? They speak loud because they don't hear themselves. Right? Sometimes they have deafness in one ear. Sometimes they have heaviness. Yani in the Arab countries, they say they have heaviness in the ear. Heaviness means does not hear clearly. في أذانهم وقر. You know, وقر means some weight. Sometimes it's the wax. They just need the cleaning, but they didn't know that before, right? So sometimes they have problem in the ear. So Thabit ibn Qais was like that. So his voice was sharp. يعني sometimes the people, they raise their voice, but they are acceptable, right? Sometimes people, their voice is irritating. Like when they raise their voice a little bit, you find that what, like, you know, they call it sonorous voice in English. Sonorous voice like a screeching. You know, like when you do like this in the board, like it gives you the shiver. You know, like some people, their voice is like that. It's, you know. So Thabit ibn Qais was not that bad, but his voice was sharp and high pitch. Right? High pitch and sharp. So Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, يعني very sensitive. His senses were very sensitive, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. His eye, his hearing, his smell, everything was sensitive for Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Pure, the best of human being, right? So, يعني تأذى. For this ayah came, Thabit ibn Qais stopped coming to the masjid. And he sat like close to his house, crying. Afraid. So, someone went to him and told him, يعني عاصم ابن عدي ابن عجلان passed by him and said, why are you crying? He said, Allah revealed the ayah and I'm thinking it is about me. I think this ayah about me. لا ترفعوا أصواتكم. Do not raise your voices in front of Rasulullah. Do not talk to him loudly and like you talk to each other. Your deeds will be perished. So he's afraid now I'm lost. I'm doomed. The man went to Rasulullah and told him, Thabit is thinking like this, he said, bring him in. Bring him in. قال له يا ثابت, O ثابت, ألا ترضى, أما ترضى, aren't you be pleased, أن تعيش حميدة, that you will be living in a beautiful life, everybody praises you, وتقتل شهيدا, and you are going to die as a shaheed, وتدخل الجنة, and you also enter Jannah. قال رضيت يا رسول الله. I accept the deal. رسول الله عمر يزيد رضيت ولا أرفع صوتي أبدا على صوت رسول الله. I will never raise my voice again in front of رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم. Later they said he used to whisper. So رسول الله will ask him what? What did you say? Again? نعم. So هذا الأدب الصحابة. They react with the آيات right away. Right away. If something wrong, they think it is about them. Not like us. If something right, oh, that's me. If something wrong, everybody else. The Sahaba said, no, anything wrong, that might be me. And if it is something right, that's everybody else, but not me. I don't deserve this. So you see the thinking? نعم. So, لا ترفعوا أصواتكم فوق صوت النبي ولا تجهروا له. يعني do not raise your voice higher than in front of Rasulullah or the higher than the voice of Rasulullah. ولا تجهروا. جهر. جهر يعني you speak loudly like I'm speaking right now. But the ulama told us الرسول صلى الله عليه وسلم himself used to raise his voice in khutbah. Yes? Because no microphones. He will raise his voice and everybody will see that his veins, jugular veins are popping out of his neck because he speak loud. So there is a reason for it. Like there is a reason now. I'm speaking, so that's not what we're talking about here. Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told his uncle Al-Abbas, when people run away in the battle of Hunayn, he said, call them, and he had a very strong voice. I told you before about the voice of Al-Abbas. One time he called the people of Mecca, few women were pregnant, they delivered. They went to labor. That's how strong his voice was, like thunder, يعني. You know? When thunder hits, sometimes you find people get scared, even we adults, right? So Al-Abbas starts saying, wa sabaha, يعني his voice was mega voice. You know, a few decibels higher than, it's like a bullet, يعني, right? So everybody got scared. So Rasul Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam told Al-Abbas to scream. Rasul Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, he called among the people, you know, the khutbah. So raising the voice is not what is disliked in itself, but for the reason of being higher than Rasulullah, for objecting to Rasulullah, for raising the voice in the presence of Rasulullah, that's not good. Why you need to shout? Sometimes Rasul Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam even will entertain someone because their culture is like that. One time he's in the army, you know, going and few rows in the back, one person he called Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam from Arab, Arabi. جاهل عربي كده يعني he is very ignorant and he said يا محمد like this. فالرسول صلى الله عليه وسلم said يا أمو I am here same نحو من صوته يعني he called him in a certain tone. رسول الله replied in the same tone. You know, sometimes you entertain people like that. So the idea here is not raising the voice, but raising the voice in the presence of رسول الله without need. Alright, Allah said that's disrespect. وَلَا تَجْهَارُوا لَهُ بِالْقَوْلِ كَجَهْرِ بَعْضُكُمْ. The way you talk to each other is okay, but the way you talk to Rasulullah is not okay. And the ulama said, anybody carrying the ilm of Allah and Rasulullah should be respected the same way. That's why they said, don't raise your voice on your parents. Because Allah said, don't tell them, uff. Just uff, the word uff. You know, uff, طبعاً, nobody says uff in here, in America. But what would they say? Something equal. Of this translated to many languages. Yeah? Of can be translated. Of in Arabic, if somebody says something you don't like, say, like this, right? That's why it's called of, يعني, right? You are not going to say, offun, offin. You are not going to do that. So when you are mad, you say, like this. That's in every language, international language, right? Sometimes they say, that's bad too. Sometimes you do like this with your hand. Or with your feet, you stomp with your feet. كل هذا same off, same thing. Off or anything indicating anger. Why the word off is mentioned? Because it is the least two-letter word explaining anger. بس. It's not like you say off, but you can say other words. يعني. Instead of saying to the parents, off in lakum, I don't like what you said. I did not say off, Sheikh. I did not say off. I said, I don't like what you do. But I did not say off. Yani Allah said off. That means anything above off is worse. Okay? So that's what I'm trying to say. So if this is for the parent, and if this is for Rasulullah, anybody in between who carries respect in the community, older person, an imam or a sheikh, a hafiz of the Quran, someone even rich in the community who helps everybody, somebody who is an authority, you respect all of those. We respect all of those as we respect anybody who is in the highest for us is Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. What will happen if you do not follow this? Allah telling the Sahaba and anybody who does, أن تحبط أعمالكم, your deeds, you have deeds, but it will be perishing. يعني some people have deeds to be destroyed. We are not talking here about the people who do not have deeds. No, we have talking about people who have accepted deeds. If you behave like this with Rasulullah, your accepted deeds will be cancelled. That is the problem. وَقَدِمْنَا إِلَى مَا عَمِلُوا مِنْ عَمَلٍ فَجَعَلْنَاهُ هَبَاءً مَنْثُورًا. And we came to all the deeds that they have acquired, and we blown them in the wind. Allah says in Yawm al-Qiyamah. So that means there is salah, there is siyam. It counts. It counts. But because they transgressed the people, because they disrespected Rasulullah, all their deeds will be wiped out. Is that what we want? Of course not. وَأَنْتُمْ لَا تَشْعُرُونَ. You are going to lose your reward while you are not aware that you lost your reward. Then Allah Azza wa Jal, after that, Subhanahu wa Ta'ala, told us another example, better example. Those who followed the order of Allah, إِنَّ الَّذِينَ يَغُضُّونَ أَصْوَاتَهُمْ. غُضُّ الصَّوْت, غَضُّ الْبَصَر means what? Lower your gaze. غَضُّ الصَّوْت, lower your voice. أَوَازْ أَيْسْتَكَرُوا. It took you a few seconds until you process. I speak Urdu, huh? أَيْسْتَكَرُوا. أَيْسْتَكَرُوا. يعني lower your voice. غض الصوت يعني, right? فإن عربي غض الصوت, غض الطرف, غض البصر, يعني غض غض يغض means what? Lowering something, lowering it down. So Allah said إن الذين those يغضون أصواتهم عند رسول الله, at the presence of Rasulullah, أولئك الذين امتحن الله قلوبهم للتقوى, those are the ones Allah tested their heart for the taqwa and they passed. لهم مغفرة وأجر عظيم. This ayah is talking about Sayyidina Abu Bakr رضي الله عنه. He used to talk to Rasulullah كأخي السرار, يعني he like somebody whispering secret to his friend. He would come يعني close to Rasulullah to talk to him, Abu Bakr رضي الله عنه. Was like that, right? So the ayah before that, لا ترفعوا, don't raise your voice, they said, صحيح البخاري said it came also about Abu Bakr and Umar رضي الله عنهم. When this group came, Rasul صلى الله عليه وسلم now talking to them and all that, so Sayyidina Abu Bakr said, يا رسول الله, make this person their Amir. He chose someone يعني. And Umar said, no, ya Rasulullah, make this person their Amir. Two different. So Abu Bakr said, you always want to be different with me. To Sayyidina Umar, يعني. Ya Umar, you ما أردت إلا مخالفة. You are just suggesting this to be different from me. He said, no, I did not do that. He said, yes, you did. He said, no, I did not. Sahaba, Abu Bakr and Umar, يعني very human beings, right? So much, yeah, this is exactly what it is. Wallahi, that's how it is narrated. قال ما أردت مخالف إلا مخالفة. قال ما أردت مخالف, أردت مخالف, لا ما أردت مخالف. And they raised their voice. والرسول صلى الله عليه وسلم heard. فsince then أبو بكر said, I will never raise my voice again. I will never raise my voice again. And both repented to Allah سبحانه وتعالى رضي الله عنهما. They, when they hear, they abide by the ayah. لا, يعني سيدنا عمر was like that, especially سيدنا عمر. If anybody remind him with an ayah, he said, يا والله, everybody understands. I did not understand. Thank you. Was like that. This is the example. رضي الله عنه. أولئك الذين امتحن الله. امتحن, امتحن in Arabic means test. امتحن means test. امتحن الله قلوبهم للتقوى. يعني Allah purified their heart like the jeweler purify the gold by putting it in the fire, so the pure gold comes out. The more fire, more impurities goes out, that it becomes a higher carats, 18, then 21. Mashallah, in Houston here, they have 22. So you give them 21, they will buy it very cheap from you. Smart, you know, because they know everybody goes to Saudi Arabia and everything. So they have to, 1 carat extra. So 21, 22, then you have 24. Okay? So Allah Azza wa Jalla said, أُولَكَ الَّذِينَ امْتَحَنَ اللَّهُ قُلُوبَهُمْ لِلتَّقْوَى, like they make imtihan for this gold and sun. لَهُمْ مَغْفِرَةٌ وَأَجْرٌ عَظِيمٌ, means they passed the test. Allah did not say, those are the ones that Allah tested them and they passed. He said, those are the ones that Allah tested them, they have forgiveness and أجر عظيم, means they passed. They passed, so they get the reward. So you have to pass to get the reward. Is that right? لهم مغفرة وأجر عظيم. Then comes إن الذين ينادونك من وراء الحجرات, the story that we talked about. They come, أكثرهم لا يعقلون. Why Allah said لا يعقلون? Means if anybody has عقل will behave better, but those people behaved negative, and this is the proof of what? Lack of what? عقل. يعني they do not have. So if somebody ask a question, you said lack of intelligence. Somebody raised the voice, lack of manners. Somebody does something, lack of, you know, anything, lack of something. So any act proves the lack of something. So when Allah said, لا يعقلون, means if they have عقل, they would not have done that. ولو أنهم صبروا حتى تخرج إليهم, what would have been better? صبر. يعني you are coming, subhanAllah, اصبر. You are coming to need to talk to Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم. Wait until he will come out. يعني he is not staying in his home forever. Just wait. Go take a bath somewhere, change your clothes, do this. That's why Rasulullah SAW, when one of the Sahaba, he was known for patience and hikmah. You know, hikmah. His name is Ashajj Abdul Qais. So his group came and they rushed to the masjid of Rasulullah, excited, to give bay'ah to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. They came and excited, like we go to Umrah, everybody does not want to go to the hotel. What did they want to go do? Go to the masjid, straight. But he stopped outside, he tied his camel, and Rasulullah is watching him, seeing, right? He tied his camel, he went on the side, he went and changed his clothes, better, wear nicer imamah, clean himself from all the dirt and everything, and then he come give bay'ah to Rasulullah. قَالَ إِنَّ فِيكَ خَصْلَتَانِ يُحِبُّهُمَ اللَّهُ وَرَسُولُهُ. You have two characteristics, Allah and His Rasul love them. Said, what are they, Rasulullah? قَالَ الْحِلْمُ وَالْأَنَاهِ, taking your time and being patient when somebody is misbehaving. His all his tribe, he's the leader. He is the leader of their tribe. They went before even talking to him. So they saw Rasulullah, right? فهو, he did not tell them, تعال هنا, come back, you are bad people, I am your leader. He did not say anything. And he took his time, patient, clean himself, and he goes, become presentable in front of Rasulullah, sallallahu alayhi wasallam. You see, so sometimes people go there and they're very excited. Shaykh, let's go do the Umrah. I said, Akhi, go up to your room, use the bathroom, take a shower, don't comb your hair because you're in Umrah clothes. Wear a cleaner ihram if you want, right? Rest for a few minutes, drink something, you know, relax. Then let's go for Umrah after that. You know, you are rushing, but you might miss something. You might forget something. So like that, when you go to Medina, go also to your hotel, change your clothes, nice, put some perfume, okay? Make sure you have miswak, your mouth smell good, everything, and go to the masjid of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, like you are gonna meet Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, okay? So, وَلَوْ أَنَّهُمْ صَبَرُوا, if they have sabr until you come back to them, لَكَانَ خَيْرًا لَهُمْ, it is would have been better for them. Why you are rushing? And this is again, وَاللَّهُ غَفُورٌ رَحِيمٌ, and Allah forgive them, يعني, because they did not know better. So Allah Azza wa Jal, He just told them the adab, what should be done. Allah did not say Allah punished them or anything. Allah said, غَفُورٌ رَحِيمٌ, وَاللَّهُ غَفُورٌ رَحِيمٌ. So this is the group of these ayat, and also telling us لا تقدموا بين يدي الله ورسوله. The ulama said Allah and His Rasul means the Quran and the Sunnah as well. After Rasulullah, Allah is there. Allah حي قيوم لا يموت يعني سبحانه وتعالى. But the Rasul صلى الله عليه وسلم passed away, but His Sunnah is among us. So we respect that as well. So if somebody tells you this hadith, this is sahih, this is the ayah of the Quran, you should just lower your head and listen. Even if you disagree about the understanding, try to find a better way to talk before you kind of object or reject something, then you appear wrong later on. It comes after that, the next ayah about story quickly, yani, that one of the companions, Al-Walid ibn Uqba ibn Abi Mu'at. Uqba ibn Abi Mu'at was a great enemy of Rasulullah in Mecca, but his son became a Muslim, but not a very strong one, right? So Rasulullah sent him one time to collect the zakah from Bani al-Mustalik. Some people, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, had issues with them, but now they agreed that they become Muslims, they are Muslims, and Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, okay, I am going to send you someone who is going to calculate your zakah and take it from you, okay? So Al-Walid had a problem with this tribe, personal problem. So when they heard that the messenger of Rasulullah, of the messenger of Allah coming, they took a small group and they were going to meet him to honor him, right? Please welcome the messenger of Allah and all of that. He saw them, he ran away back to Rasulullah. He got scared of them, right? He said, Ya Rasulullah, they left Islam. They refused to give me something and they were about to kill me. And Rasul Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam got very angry. And he is going to send them Khalid ibn Walid. So Khalid ibn Walid to fight. So he find them azan, salah and everything. So he said, Ya Rasulullah, they were good. They give me actually everything. They said, you know, someone come and we were going to meet him and he ran away from us. We don't know why. And they, this is one narration. Other narration say that they went themselves later to apologize to Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam before he sent anybody. Rasulullah Sallam did not believe them. And he said, you know, if you do this again, I'm going to send you someone, right? Who's going to fight? He said, no. We seek refuge from Allah's anger and his Rasul anger. Wallahi, yani, we wanted to do this and this and this. And Allah revealed the ayah that, Ya ayyuha alladhina amanu, O you who believe, including Rasulullah. In ja'akum fasiqun binaba'in, with the news, fatabayyanu. Be careful. Verify before you accuse someone, then you regret later on what you said. The scholars now had a big deal about the word fasiq here. How he's a companion and fasiq at the same time. Yes? So it's a problem now, problematic issue. So here, Allah Azza wa Jal is talking, this is the Sahaba and the Tabi'een and all the scholars of Tafsir. Allah is talking about the general rule. Right? He says this to show you that if you do something like that, you might be a fasiq, right? So in Arabic language, sometimes you call someone something that you're afraid they're going to be. They are not that exactly, but they might turn to become like that, right? So be careful. When someone comes to you with the news, you have to verify, right? Verify. And when you come with the news, you'll be careful also how you deliver it. You don't want to regret later on. وَعْلَمُوا أَنَّ فِيكُمْ رَسُولَ اللَّهِ. You have to know that Rasulullah is there. What is his main job, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? If he listens to everything that you do or you want, it will become very hard for you. So sometimes people ask Rasulullah for something, not knowing that the opposite is right. Like in Hudaybiyah, we talked about in Surah Al-Fatih. They wanted something, but Rasulullah wanted something. They did not accept it first, but later they found the goodness in it. So Allah is telling us that every decision Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam takes. But here there is a secret word in this ayah. Allah did not say, if he obeys you, it will be hard. He said, if he obeys you in most of your issues. That means some of your issues, you are right. يعني the Sahaba, in some issues, they were right. Not always their opinion was wrong. يعني they asked Rasulullah, if this is your opinion, or in wahi from Allah. He said, no, it's my opinion. He said, this is better, Ya Rasulullah. So that means sometimes you have good decisions. But majority in the affairs of the deen, be careful because Rasulullah's opinion is better. Okay? But Allah make the deen muhabbab, habbaba ilaykum al-iman, wa zayyanahu fi qulubikum. Iman became something nice in your heart. And he make you despise, and it's like al-kufr, wal-fusuq, wal-isyan, disobedience. Ulaika hum rashidun, those are the people who are guided. May Allah make us among them. We said, Ya Allah, Ya Allah, make iman dear to our heart. وَزَيِّنُوا فِي قُلُوبِنَا Decorate it in our heart. Make it dear to us, beautiful. And make us hate and loathe kufr وَالْفُسُوقُ وَالْعِصْيَانِ And make us among Rashideen, Ya Allah Azza Jal. This is fadl from Allah. It is the ni'mah from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. فَضْلًا مِّنَ اللَّهِ وَنِعْمَةً وَاللَّهُ عَلِيمٌ حَكِيمٌ Allah Azza wa Jal is Alim, Allah Azza wa Jal is wise subhanahu wa ta'ala. Last of our session today, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says about when the two groups of believers, they fight. وَإِنْ طَائِفَتَانِ مِنَ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ اقْتَتَلُوا They're fighting with each other. فَأَصْلِحُوا بَيْنَهُمَا There has to be a third group, arbitrator or mediators, right? They bring them together. But one of them became baghi now. Like, you know, did not listen and they went and transgressed the other one. Allah said, that third group, fight the one that transgressed until it comes back to the way of Allah. Right? تَفِيَ إِلَى أَمْرِ اللَّهِ فَإِنْ فَاتْ Then if they stop, then bring them back together. So try to bring them back together. If one of them transgressed, fight that one. If it's calmed down, then bring them back together. Allah still called them brothers. أَخَوَيْكُمْ وَاتَّقُوا اللَّهِ And fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَأَقْسِطُوا إِنَّ اللَّهَ حِبُّ الْمُقْسِطِينَ إِنَّمَا الْمُؤْمِنُونَ إِخْوَةٌ See? Even they're fighting each other, right? Allah said what? إخوة فَأَصْلِحُوا بَيْنَ أَخَوَيْكُمْ سيدنا علي when the Khawarij came out and they said you are a kafir Muawiyah is a kafir and all that when they asked him what you say he said إِخْوَانُنَا They are our brothers بَغَوْ عَلَيْنَا They transgressed us He did not take the word أخ from them They are our brothers but they are wrong You know what I mean? But now when somebody is wrong or transgress you, kafir. لا, أعوذ بالله, ليه? Why? He is your brother, but he's wrong. He's your brother, deviated. He's your brother, sinner, but your brother, still. If he become kafir, خلاص يعني, out. So be careful, واتقوا الله لعلكم ترحمون. طبعا, I did not give enough justice to this last two, three ayahs, but this section is loaded. So inshallah, I'll try my best to repeat certain aspect of it with Abdul Sabur, inshallah, right? But we'll stop here because this last two ayahs, they need more explanation than this, okay? So inshallah, Rabbil Alameen, for the sake of time now, we'll stop here, but for the fairness to the ayat of Allah, we record it later, inshallah. You agree? جزاكم الله خيرا والحمد لله رب العالمين
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وعلى آله وصحبه ومن تبعه وله وسلم تسليما كثيرا All praises due to Allah May Allah's peace and blessings be upon His beloved Prophet Muhammad صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وسلم أما بعد to proceed We still with Surah Al-Hujurat And we talked about it and we mentioned that this is the Surah of society It is the Surah of morals and manners It is the Surah of the individual, the family and the society at large This is the Surah of showing the etiquettes with the leader, the head of the state, the religious leader, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and of course whoever follows his footsteps sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, how to be polite, talking and addressing and dealing with him. Then it is also about the verification of the news. Like when somebody tell you something about someone else, you have to verify, you have to authenticate, you have to substantiate what they are saying before you believe it and act upon it. Now we are with verse number 9 and number 10. They are two very important verses, subhanAllah, because it talks about dispute resolution. Faddul Munaza'at in Arabic it's called dispute. Faddul Munaza'at means dispute resolution. When people fight or disagree on an individual level or family level or tribe level or country level, it does not matter. There is a fiqh in that, you know, jurisprudence in that. We are not getting to the fiqh aspect of it, the juristic aspect of it, but we are talking about it from the tafsir. There is Allah Azza wa Jal here saying وَإِن طَائِفَتَانِ مِنَ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ قُتَتَلُوا فَأَصْلِحُوا بَيْنَهُمَا فَإِن بَغَتْ إِحْدَاهُمَا عَلَى الْأُخْرَى فَقَاتِلُوا الَّتِي تَبْغِي حَتَّى تَفِيءَ إِلَى أَمْرِ اللَّهِ فَإِن فَاءَتْ فَأَصْلِحُوا بَيْنَهُمَا بِالْعَدْلِ وَأَقْسِطُوا إِنَّ اللَّهَ يُحِبُّ الْمُقْسِطِينَ If two groups of the believers fight, then you have to mediate and bring them together, meet middle way. But if one of them transgress and continue in their transgression, then you have to stand beside the transgressor and fight the transgressor until they repent and admit defeat and admit mistake, bring them back to the table, the negotiation table, and do what you started doing first. Once they both come to the order of Allah Azza wa Jal, then bring them together with justice, without transgressing anybody or without being biased toward anybody. وَأَقَصِتُوا always establish justice. Allah loves those who establish justice. Here, subhanAllah, amazingly, we see that how Allah Azza wa Jal did not take away the description of iman, faith, from both. Even though one is right, one is wrong. One is transgressor, one is transgressed. Yet Allah called mu'mineen. طَائِفَتَانِ مِنَ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ. Of course, there is a reason of revelation, and I want you to know that reason of revelation does not mean specifically that ayah was revealed about that specific incident. That could be the case. They ask you about this, tell them that. Someone come and ask Rasulullah about something or does something, then the ayah is revealed about it. Tabbat yada Abi Lahabin wa tab. It's about Abu Lahab, the uncle of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Straightforward. He told Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam that you do not have children. Allah said he is the one who is not going to have any offspring from his through his children and so on. So we know exactly like that. We learn from it that do not insult Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, or not insult someone or accuse someone or gloat in someone because they have something, because you might get it as well. We learn from that. This is the under topic there. But there is a reason of revelation. But sometimes reason of the revelation means this ayah is coming to treat a pattern in society, and at that time there are more than one case that took place. So many of the narrators or the mufassirin or the scholars will say this ayah is revealed because of that. It does not mean because of that specifically or because of that only, but it happened to be at the same time. Also, sometimes an ayah comes and it applies to someone. So when they said this ayah is revealed about us people of Ansar, it is not like they did something and then the ayah came. No, the ayah is describing an aspect that some people are practicing. So Allah is praising or criticizing or something like that. So I want you to understand the reason of revelation within that context. So with that said, Allah Azza wa Jal is about this ayah here. The reason of revelation is narrated in Bukhari, Muslim, Musnad al-Imam Ahmad. And Ibn Jarir also mentioned it in his Tafsir that Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam, Sahaba told him, Anas ibn Malik narrating the hadith, Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Sahaba told him, Ya Rasulullah, if you come to Abdullah ibn Ubay ibn Salul, the leader of hypocrisy over there, and he is the one who wanted to become crowned a king, and he was about to be crowned the king of Medina, then Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam went and took it away from him. So he had the grudge and he could not come into peace until he died as a hypocrite, wal'iyadhu billah. And he did not save any chance to hurt Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam morally, physically, in you name it. So the Sahaba told him, Ya Rasulullah, if you just go to him, maybe it will soften his heart. So Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam went, and the land was not good land. It is having like some dirt in there and some like smell. And then Rasulullah ﷺ took his donkey, but the donkey, as any animal, urinated. So the smell came out. So Abdullah ibn Ubayy ibn Salul said, get away from here to Rasulullah ﷺ. إِلَيْكَ عَنِّي, get away from me. The smell of your donkey is harming me. So Abdullah ibn Rawaha, from his tribe, Abdullah ibn ﷺ told him, Wallahi, the smell of the urine of the donkey of Rasulullah ﷺ is much, much better than your own smell. You don't talk to Rasulullah ﷺ like that. So another person from the followers of Abdullah ibn Ubayy ibn Salul, the hypocrite, started insulting Abdullah ibn Rawaha. People from Abdullah ibn Rawaha started insulting him, and then they started fighting with each other and went physical. So Allah revealed that ayah to Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam to bring these people together and all of that, because they tribalism it was the incentive for that, enticed them. Tribalism enticed everybody. Also, they say that instead of that Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam was going to Abdullah ibn Ubayy ibn Salul, he was going to visit Sa'd ibn Ubadah in his sickness, the leader of Ansar also, and he passed by Abdullah ibn Ubayy ibn Salul, then the incident happened. There is another narration as well that says that a person from Al-Ansar, his name is Imran, and he was married. Then he has a dispute with his wife, Umm Zayd. Then the wife wanted to visit her family, and he rejected and he locked her in the house. Kind of told her you're not going, and he locked her in the house somehow. Nobody enters from her family. So she sent someone to her family, told them the situation. So her family came to take her out by force. Then he talked to his tribe, and his family also came to block them from taking her, the wife, out. So it became a problem between the two tribes. Then Rasulullah went and he brought them together, and he saved that family from the dispute and saved the two tribes from fighting. So those were small examples how dispute resolution, there has to be someone to mediate. Mediation. Even here in this country, subhanAllah, in the United States, there is anybody files for divorce, they ask you to go for mediation first. You have to go to mediation. You have to. You cannot bypass that. And subhanAllah, they make it part of the law over here. So you go there, and 60 days, the judge will not even look at anything for people to reconcile. And those are Islamic steps, by the way. First is reconciliation. Means both come down to the middle and fix the problem. So husband and wife, for example, they come and said, you know what, let's sit and see what you want, what I want, and they meet in the middle and do that themselves. And that's why here 60 days, the judge leaves you hanging there. If you insist, that means you do not want to compromise. You do not want to reconcile. So that's called islah in Arabic, reconciliation. Islah, sulh. And Allah mentioned like that in Surah An-Nisa about husband and wife. He says, when imra'atun khafat min ba'alaha nushuzan aw iradan fala junaha 'alayhima an yusliha baynahuma sulh aw yusalaha baynahuma sulh. Yani the family come together, or both of them they come together. Different qira'ah, different meaning. طيب. What if it does not work? Then mediation. That someone comes in the middle and does the job that both of them refusing to, because their heart is not there. So they said, you know, okay, you come here, or sit in different rooms and start mediating. And that's what they do here, subhanAllah. The next level is arbitration. And sometimes the court orders here arbitration. Arbitration means whatever the person says, the judge endorses. So arbitration is a step before going to court. So the judge would say, okay, I assign such imam as the arbitrator. So they are not coming for me to mediate here. Whatever I say becomes binding. They have to sign a paper. And once done, the court will endorse it. Then the last step is the court or the qadi. I'm talking in the Islamic model that it's followed here in America more than we think. Of course, the application will not be Islamic, but I'm talking about the process. If this process we apply as a Muslim community, lots of families, in my opinion, will be saved. And that's my thesis and my PhD, by the way. So it is that. If we follow the model here in the American system or the legal system Islamically, it will work great. It will work miracles for us. But the people, unfortunately, short-sighted, they want the money. So the man does not want to give the money. And the woman wants to take all the money, or as much as she can take. So both about the greed, about how much I can take, how much can I revenge, how much I can bring the other person down, they are forgetting about all these steps. Aslah first, they both have to sit and talk about it, which happens here. Like sometimes the couple say, you know what, we're not working together, let's talk. So they finish, they go in or go out, it's either or, but mostly they will come in, because once they start talking, lots of things will, you know, go away. All these bad feelings and stuff. Doesn't work, then you bring someone in the middle, because you cannot face each other. You want somebody in the middle to bring you together. Then arbitration, someone in the middle, but he has the power. And then after that, you go to the judge. When we're talking about Islamic system, the judge would be Shari'i judge, but it becomes binding. So we have a Sharia court or something like that. And work with the system here. The system would love that, by the way. That we want to say we want the power to arbitrate in our mosque thing. So any Muslim couple will go to the court, will say you go for arbitration. And if we as Muslims start feeling that, then, or doing that, then everybody, before they think, they know that it is going to be solved within the Muslim community, most likely it's not going to reach to arbitration. But the problem is we are not helping ourselves. We as a Muslim Jama'ah are not helping ourselves to establish the rule of Allah Azza wa Jalla. So everybody said, you know what, I don't want the masjid to do anything with it. I just wanted the court, I wanted the system. Because they calculated right, and the lawyers told them, you're going to make this much money. So they are forgetting that they are losing their dignity, they are losing their integrity, they are losing part of their religion, they are losing the obedience of Allah, they are losing their akhirah. They are not paying attention to all those big things for some money, subhanAllah. I said in a khutbah one time, if the Islam gives you 10,000 and the court will give you 200,000, take the 10,000 and be a good Muslim. It's much better. Wallah, you take all this money, no barakah in it. No barakah in it. Shaitan will be on it. Sickness will come to you. You lose your self-respect. Your children will not respect you. The great-grandchildren will say, oh, we have a grandmother this, or we have a grandfather did this. It's not good. It's not worth it. All the money of the world does not worth you to be mentioned in a negative way after your death, let alone when you are alive. It's not worth it at all. So Allah Azza wa Jal here is saying, طَائِفَتَنِي مِنَ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ. Yani they did not lose. When they are fighting, they did not lose that. Why? Because they come back to the foundation. When they said, يَا مُؤْمِنِينَ, come here, they sit. Right? Because if you said, oh, I'm not from the mu'mineen, then we have a problem now. But if they are true mu'mineen, they will come and talk. So, Rasul Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam fixed that. You see this ayat coming right after verification of news. That also hints to us that sometimes when you do not verify things, that you act upon it and it can lead to dispute and it can lead to fighting in the society. Imagine now, somebody comes in the masjid and tell you, you know what? I heard this from that brother in the parking lot after Isha yesterday. Said, he said that about me? Yes, he said that about you. Then you go and call your family goes against his family, and then it's a big problem. So that's why the order of the ayat comes. Like, if you do not verify, it is not only going to cause problem between two people, it might cause problem between two families, it might cause problem between two societies, it might cause problem between two countries. So that's why if you have adab with the head of the state, you are going to verify the news. And if you verify the news, you avoid bigger conflicts. And if you avoid bigger conflicts, then we behave with each other properly. And the circle will go full circle, and the circle will be complete. SubhanAllah. Imam al-Bukhari, rahimahullah, has fiqh and understanding. And he says this is a dalil that if fighting happens between Muslims, it does not take them away from Islam. They're still Muslims but disobedient. طبعاً معتزلة, those who are like, you know, they reason and rationalize everything, Khawarij, upstate, they do not believe in that. They said anybody who commit a major sin, he's going to be in hellfire no matter what. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he was in the minbar one time, khutbah, and then Al-Hasan came. So Rasulullah started looking at the people and looking at him, and he said, my son is Sayyid, and may Allah make him the one who fixed between two fighting groups of the Muslims. And actually, Al-Hasan is the one who brought the people together at the time of Muawiyah ibn Abi Sufyan radiallahu anhu, after his father's death, Ali ibn Abi Talib's death. Muawiyah took over, and people elected Al-Hasan to become the Khalifa. So he was Khalifa in Hijaz, Muawiyah Khalifa in Al-Sham, and then, you know, the fitna is going to start. So Al-Hasan said, you know what, I am going to give it up. That's why the people poisoned him and killed him later, you know, because he did not want to fight. And actually, because of him, lots of bloodshed was avoided until, you know, the bigger fitna happened after Muawiyah ibn Abi Sufyan, when Yazid came, and then Husayn came out, radiallahu anhu, and he was killed. And all this mess happened after that, that we're still suffering from its results right now. So Al-Hasan ibn Ali chose not to fight, so bigger problem would happen. He saved lots of people. So Rasulullah said, Allah will fix between two groups of Muslim. So Rasulullah did not take away the description of Islam. And Al-Hasan ibn Ali, until he died, now we look at the history. What did he do to fix? That's the only incident. So that's what Rasulullah was referring to, because there is no other way that he makes sulh between two tribes, for example. No. This is the only one that he brings to people. So Rasulullah was referring to this. So that's an answer for people who say Shia or Sunnah or this or that. Rasulullah did not say this one kafir, this one kafir. He said both are Muslimin and Al-Hasan will bring them together. That's why the family, Sayyid family, they called Sayyid, because they are the children of Al-Hasan ibn Ali, because Rasulullah called him Sayyid. So Muslims has to fight the one who transgress until they come back again. That's why Sayyidina Ali, when they told him Khawarij, are they kuffar or they are Muslim? He said, "Ikhwanuna baghaw alayna." They are our brothers who transgressed us. That's why I'm fighting them with the sword. But they are still our brother. So he did not. Why? Because this makes a big difference. Like when you fight and you win, you do not capture their women. You do not like enslave their people. There are rules. They are not kuffar, because if they are kuffar, then, you know, everything that when they are defeated, they become enslaved at that time. Yeah. But if you consider them Muslims, you are actually bringing them back to the fold of Islam. You are not fighting them because they are against that. You're fighting them to bring them back to their senses. So he still identified them as our brothers. SubhanAllah, that's a fiqh. This is a high level of understanding. So Allah Azza wa Jalla said, you know, always have to establish justice. Allah loves those who establish justice. Al-Imam Muslim, Al-Imam Nasa'i narrated from the hadith of Abdullah ibn Amr that Rasulullah Sallam said, Al-Muqsitun, those who establish justice with Allah Azza wa Jalla yawm al-qiyamah on pulpits of light on the right-hand side of Al-Arsh, the throne of Allah Azza wa Jalla, those who establish justice to those under their responsibility. Allah Azza wa Jalla said, always bring people together, even the least of dispute. And the Muslims are always brothers and sisters of each other. إِنَّمَا الْمُؤْمِنُونَ إِخْوَةِ. They are brothers, your brothers and sisters. إِخْوَةِ here does not mean brothers only, mean brothers and sisters. Rasulullah said the women are the sisters of men. So every rule comes, and then men addressed, women are addressed as well. Unless there is some distinction there. إِنَّمَا الْمُؤْمِنُونَ إِخْوَةِ. Brothers and sisters. فَأَصْلِحُوا بَيْنَ أَخَوَيْكُمْ. Always make sulh in the least of dispute. You find two people that try to bring, and you have a great reward. Allah said, nobody has goodness in what they do except whoever order enjoying good or forbid bad. أمر بصدقة أو معروف, or give charity, order people to give charity or enjoying good, or fix the affairs between people, make sulh. You have a great reward from Allah عز وجل. واتقوا الله لعلكم ترحمون. Allah عز وجل will fear Allah عز وجل, so Allah will have mercy. You notice here that Allah Azza wa Jalla said, fear Allah when there is two brothers fighting. But he did not say, taqu Allah when the two groups are fighting. The two groups fighting, there is a big fitna anyways. But when the two brothers fighting, Allah said, fear Allah because you don't want it to become bigger. So you won't contain it. But the other one is already out of containment. So that's why here. It's all about Muslims here and dispute resolution. So this brings us to the end of this lesson. And Allah is always in the help of the people as long as they're helping each other. Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said that. Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said the Muslim is a brother for his Muslim brother, does not transgress, and it does not give him away to their enemy. Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said we are like one building, strengthening each other. We are like one body, strengthening each other. And this brings us to the end of today's class. May Allah make us among those who love each other for His sake, subhanahu wa ta'ala. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.